We're going to continue with our scripture reading. And today, the scripture reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. If you would like to follow along with your own device, or if you have your Bible with you, or if you would just like to follow along on the screen. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. All came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together, and all had things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as they had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, friends, we're in a movie theater. And if I'm going to be in a movie theater, then I'm going to start my message with a movie reference. And arguably, I'm going to refer to what is arguably the most successful, the most popular film franchise of all time. I don't know what you would say, but I would say Star Wars. Star Wars, yes. Okay, so just for a moment, I want you to think in your head what your favorite Star Wars movie is. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that none of you are thinking of the prequels. Maybe a few of you are thinking of The Force Awakens. But how many of you would you say Return of the Jedi was your favorite? Show of hands. Okay, got a few hands. What about the original Star Wars, A New Hope? Okay, now Empire Strikes Back. Okay, there's like three of us, but that is my favorite one, Empire Strikes Back. I don't know why. I know the first one's a classic, and Returns kind of wraps everything up, but the Empire Strikes Back, there's just some good stuff that happens in that, and especially around the relationship between Luke and Yoda, right, and having to learn from Yoda. And there's a scene where as Luke is being instructed to lift rocks and to balance on one arm and to do all these things and to use the force to make all these things move, he's then told to lift his X-Wing out of the swamp. And he says that it's too big. I can't do it. It's just too big. Yoda goes into this whole kind of Buddhist explanation about size matters not. Look at me. Does my size matter? And then he goes on. I don't want to get this wrong, and I'm not going to talk in my Yoda voice this morning. Well, I'm hearing an awe. Just meet me in the lobby, and I'll do my Yoda voice later. But he says, you must feel the force around you, here, between you, me, the tree, the rock, everywhere. Yes, even between the land and the ship. You know, this explanation of the force and how it's in everything and between everything, it's not a perfect analogy, but it starts a conversation about where God is, who God is, where does God exist, right? It's not a perfect analogy, but it gets the conversation going about who exactly God is and how we can talk about God. Where does God live? Growing up, I would say the Apostles' Creed in church. It was a statement of what I believed. And in that, I would say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And then there's a section that says, I believe in Jesus Christ. And then we go through that section. And at the end of that section, it says, and on the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead, or the quick and the dead. And so for whatever reason, I grew up learning this and believing that God just lived in heaven. He just lived up there. He was an old dude with white hair sitting in a gold throne, judging if I was good or bad, if I was naughty or nice. Basically, I believed that God was Santa Claus. And that's what I learned growing up. I learned a lot of things growing up. I learned that if you eat carrots, it makes your eyesight better. That's something my mom told me all the time. I learned that a doctor a day, or an apple a day, keeps a doctor away. A doctor a day, I'd be living at the hospital. A doctor a day. An apple a day keeps the doctor away. I also learned that if you don't eat your meat, you can't have any pudding. How can you have any pudding if you don't eat your meat? Anybody that just laughed next to you knows Pink Floyd's The Wall. But those are a lot of food-based things I learned. I learned all of these things, but I also learned that church was a place that you went to on Sunday. That the church day was Sunday. And that church was a stained glass building with a tall steeple with a cross on top of it. And that church people looked a certain way and acted a certain way. And that we used a certain type of language, and it would sound very foreign to many people. That we would use terms like Eucharist and liturgy and narthex and catechism and gospel. Even the word gospel, if we think about it, might sound a little strange to somebody who didn't grow up going to church. But these were the things I learned growing up, and these were the things that I believed. That church was a particular place that you went to on a particular day of the week. Now, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with worshiping God on Sunday. Obviously. There's nothing wrong with that. And I'm not saying that we need to stop the way that we've been doing church for thousands and thousands of years, and that we need to board up traditional sanctuaries and get rid of the pews and shut all this stuff down. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is that we've been trained to think a certain way for so long that we believe that church can only happen in particular places on particular days with particular people. That we have grown up believing that church could only happen in these sacred spaces on certain days of the week. But here at Peace Tree, we dare to ask, how did Jesus worship? Say that with me. How did Jesus worship? How did he worship? You know, we have to look to the stories about him in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And as we look to him, we see just a different way of living. You know, was he more concerned about somebody's outward appearance or their inward condition? Was Jesus more concerned about the condition of hair and makeup or the condition of the heart? You know, what did Jesus really care about when he spent time with people? And how did he worship God with these people? How did Jesus worship? So as we look to him, we see that he gives us this grand vision for church, one that allows us to say, church can happen anywhere. You know, Jesus preached almost every day of the week he preached. He got in trouble at times because he was spending the Sabbath working and preaching and walking and spending time with the people and doing things that they were told were against the law. You know, he breaks bread with his friends. He shares meals with people. Sometimes he even would invite himself into other people's homes unannounced. And this is the way that he decided to do church. This was what he taught his disciples about worshiping God, that he could preach from a boat out on the water because the sound would travel further and would carry farther so that more people could hear him, that he could give a sermon from the side of a mountain, that he could feed thousands and thousands of people in open fields. He didn't constrain his ministry to the temple or to a synagogue because Jesus believed that church can happen anywhere. And his disciples, his followers, his students, his friends, they spend 3+ years of their lives following him, and they're watching his every movement, and they're watching what he does. And then they start to learn what Jesus does and how Jesus does church. And so for the disciples even, they are on their own. They are left by themselves once Jesus dies and is resurrected and ascends into heaven. And then the disciples look around and say, well, he told us to go make more disciples. He told us to go to the ends of the earth. And so they start to do all of the things that they learned directly from Jesus. How did he live his life? How did he worship God? Well, he believed that church can happen anywhere. So we're going to do that too. Then they started inviting people into their homes. They started breaking bread together. They started healing folks on the street. They just formed new communities, and they formed a new culture a new Christian culture that was different than what was around them because they believed that church could happen anywhere. And so perhaps people are wary or intimidated by the church today or by church people because we've made it too complex. We've made it too exclusive. But friends, what we're doing right now is that we are taking church to where people are. I mean, how many of you, a show of hands, maybe not in this exact auditorium or this movie theater, how many of you have seen a movie at a Malco theater in the last year? And that looks like pretty much everybody in this place. I mean, this is a place that we are comfortable meeting in. And this is a place where if you were willing to take that next step and to invite somebody who maybe has never gone to church or would never go to the church that you grew up in, but would come to a movie theater because church can happen anywhere. This is the challenge that God is giving us. This is what the disciples were living out. They were doing all of the things that they saw Jesus do. They prayed for their neighbors. They broke bread together. They had fun with one another. And they did this all in the name of Christ. That's what it means to follow Jesus's example. You know, every time we get together, we're doing church. Every single time that I'm able to speak with somebody in Kroger or in Walmart or pumping gas, these things literally happened just yesterday. That was church for me, right? Being able to stop and to see friends and to talk to them and ask them, how is your day going? How is life? How is your family? That, to me, is doing church. That is perhaps more meaningful than anything else I can do throughout the week. Anytime we get together, anytime we work together to try to transform the world, you know, we know what is beyond these walls. We can turn on the 5 o'clock news, the 10 o'clock news, and see what's happening in our cities and in our towns. We know what's happening in the world. Anytime we dare to say we can transform the world, we can help our sisters and our brothers who are in need, when we do that, we are being the church. And that is something that I hope as we leave here today, we can understand that you didn't just go to church, but you were the church today. Church is not just a place that we go to, but church is something that we do. It is a verb. Anytime that we help someone in need, we are being the church. Jesus tells a story to his followers one day. He says that anytime that you help somebody who is considered the least of society, anytime you give them food or give them clothes or give them water, you're not just necessarily giving it to that person. But you are serving Christ. You are worshiping God. You are being the church. Anywhere you do it, anytime you do it, because church can happen anywhere. That is what he taught his disciples, and that is what they did in his name. It may not make sense to us to think about handing water to somebody as we are pulling off the interstate or 240 or Bill Morris Parkway. And there's somebody there with a sign at Winchester or at Get Well or Perkins asking for help, saying that they have the cancer, saying that they will work for food or money. It may not make sense to think, okay, well, what is this going to do? This is a Band-Aid. It's not going to help anything. But if we're able to just take that step and take that risk of putting ourselves out there and saying, I will pray for you. What is your name? This is all I have to give, a bottle of water. It may not make sense because we think about God as Father or Son sitting in heaven, but if we think about God as the Holy Spirit, if we think about God as an all-encompassing spirit that is between everything and in everything, then we can see that God is everywhere, a force for good in this world. And if we can believe that God is a spirit that exists inside of each and every one of us, then God is everywhere. Church can happen anywhere because God is everywhere. That is what we learn from Christ, and that is what his disciples taught us through the generations. God is everywhere, in everything, in you and in me, in the tree and in the rock, and all over creation. God's thumbprints are all over creation. And church can happen anywhere because God is everywhere. And if we believe that, then God is in this theater. And God is where you work. And God is in my apartment complex. And God is on the street where you live. God is everywhere. So church can happen anywhere. Anytime you get together with friends, you are being the church. And don't feel this obligation that to go to church, but when you leave here, realize that we were the church this morning. Anytime you study God's word, anytime you serve someone in need or show hospitality to a stranger, you are being the church. And so here is, again, that challenge for you this week is to do church in a place that you would not normally think you could do church. I don't know what that place looks like for you. It might be the break room at work. And it may be a coworker that you know is maybe going through something, or maybe a coworker you don't know that well. And it's taking the time to talk to them about family and to talk to them about faith. And then maybe at the end of that conversation, inviting them over to your house for dinner one night with your family. And then to be able to exchange friendships and to exchange conversation and to realize that when we do that, our home becomes a church. What would be great is to see, you know, every person in here realize that you are a minister of Christ, and to see every home in this community as a potential church, and to look at all these churches that exist in Collierville as church movements that are ready to sweep this nation. That is what is wrapped up in this challenge, is to be the church in places we would not normally think about doing church, about talking to parents that are in the pickup line or at the PTA meeting. And being able to form new relationships with people. You maybe have never asked them, do you have a church? Do you go to church? Maybe you don't even need to start with that question, but how about you come over to our family's house for dinner? And why don't you start with that? Because to me, that is how Jesus did church. He didn't decide to one day put a sign that said he was going to have a worship service on the side of a mountain. He just lived his life. He didn't announce to people that he was going to be on a boat in the middle of the lake and he would be preaching from a boat. He just did it. People were drawn to that. And if you start building relationships with your friends, then you will be more like Christ. You will then put into action his mission in this world to make disciples, to draw people closer to God, to love God by loving others. Another part of this challenge might be to visit a house group this week or this month, because we're really only scratching the surface this morning. Some of you have been to a house group before, and you know that we really do spend time getting into the Bible, that the kids are running around. We've got five-month-olds and six-month-olds that are learning to creep and crawl. We've got people that want to be grandmas, but they're not grandmas yet, holding babies over their shoulders and burping them, and we eat a meal and we share the Bible together. And that is being the church in someone's home in the Harpers Ferry neighborhood or down Windleaf Drive or at the Mellow Mushroom on a Monday night. That is part of the challenge this week, is to say, how can I do church at school? How can I do church in my neighborhood? How can I do church where I work? They devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. This is what the early Christians did. This is how they were the church. They ate food together. They discussed the teachings of Jesus together. They prayed for one another. They got involved in their communities. That is what we are being called to do today, my friends. That is what it means to be the church. That is what it means to follow Christ's example. And if we can do those things, then we will be the church. We are the church. And if the church is made up of people and not by bricks and mortar, then my friends, truly, 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 church can happen anywhere. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I'm inviting Hannah to come back up and lead us in our closing song. Today, if you're in this place and you're wanting to learn more about Peace Tree and you're wanting to learn more about doing church this way, doing church in a non-traditional way and trying to reach people with maybe some methods and some tools that have never been used in this town or in your city, then please, please, please come find me. Or you can also message the church over Facebook. But please let us know if this interests you, if you want to be a part of this team and be a part of this congregation, because we really are trying to reach people. That is our number one concern and our number one priority. I hope that you will join us again 4 weeks from now, and I'll remind you before we leave this place. But if there's somebody in this room who has maybe felt a call into ministry, or maybe is feeling a call to discipleship, you want to follow Christ, you want to learn more about what that means, then I'm going to be sitting down here in the front. You can find me during this last song, or you can find me out in the lobby. But if you feel that God is calling you to do something today, and you clearly hear God's voice, then really we need to ask, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? And if you need help making a plan, you want me to hold you accountable to it, you want to learn more about what it means to follow Christ or what it means to do church this way, then please, please come and find me. But at this time, if we can, let's stand as we join together in our closing song.